Hey, I'm Nick Nunns, owner and head brewer at TRVE Brewing in Denver, Colorado, and you're watching The Beer Diaries.
Hey Nick, how are you?
Good to meet you, man.
Pleasure.
Thanks for coming into TRVE.
Can't wait. Do you want to try some beer? Check
Absolutely,
the place?
Man. Come on in.
All right. The bar is pretty awesome.
Yeah, I'm really stoked with the whole design. It's nice that it lets you see people from kind of each end of the bar and you know who else is hanging out here.
Oh, yeah, the way it's kind of angled.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
So it makes for a good sort of communal feel to it,
it's
you know?
A lovely piece of wood.
Yeah.
And if you have taps, but they're mystery taps, only you guys know what are on.
That's it, man.
Do you fill all eight sometimes? Or?
We haven't yet. We've been struggling to keep up so far.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Actually getting those eight taps flowing is gonna be a big hurdle for us.
Have you expanded recently, I guess?
We did, or? Yeah. So we just doubled our capacity.
Well, that's great. Always great to hear. I mean, if you can do that, that's a great position.
The phrase, a good problem to have, has been uttered more than once.
Oh, yeah, yeah. How many beers do you have on tap right now?
We got six on tap right now.
I checked out online. I mean, you guys got a huge range. I mean, you guys do some really interesting, unique styles.
We try to vary it as much as we can. You know, we do a lot of seasonal stuff. We do stuff that's kind of appropriate for one particular season or another, one time of year. And some things have been retired, some things have not.
Do you have a bestseller? Like any one particular?
Man, our IPA just flies.
Does it? We do a double as well, I think.
We do a double, we just released
that. The straight up IPA goes like crazy.
Yeah, it's insane.
So obviously, you know, this is a pretty unique space. I mean, it's pretty long and narrow. Something good to work with, bad to work with?
Like? It was great. It was exactly what I was looking for. You know, we wanted a shotgun bar. We wanted that feel of that, you know, really long space.
Yeah.
I'm from Boston originally, so, you know, I'm used to spaces like this.
Yeah.
In Colorado, you don't typically find stuff like this. So it was really nice to find a space that kind of worked for what my vision was.
Some folks will take the brew house and they'll close it off and put it behind drywall or leave maybe a little window or something. You guys just left it totally open.
Yeah, we wanted people to be able to come in here and actually see what was going on and
like
see the equipment.
So you have the three fermenters going.
Yeah, we got 3 7-barrel fermenters and our 4-barrel brew house.
This is storage space right here.
Yeah, right. Sid's in the process of cleaning some kegs.
Yeah,
so, you know,
yeah.
This is kind of what it looks like during the day when we're actually brewing.
Is your cold room sort of back in here?
Right, like, behind you right now.
I saw like the taps had the pipes leading to here.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, exactly. So.
And there's the brew house right there.
Yep.
And it's obviously well labeled.
Yeah. Real tiny, you know, it's a great small setup. We love it. The nicest thing about having a small brew house is we've been able to turn stuff over so quick that we can just rapidly dial stuff in.
So how many brews would you do a day? Would you do more?
We
than
typically
one,
to fill one of these guys now, we'll brew twice,
okay,
which works out great. You know, it's either a long day or two average days.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
So.
Well, that's cool. No, well, let's we'll sit down and talk a little more. This is awesome space, and I mean, awesome vibe. Lots
Thanks,
to
man.
Talk about.
Thanks.
Hey folks, I'm Greg from the Beer Diaries. I am here at TRVE Brewing in Denver, Colorado with Nick Nunns. He's the owner, head brewer, and we're talking beer and what TRVE is all about.
Absolutely.
So thanks for having us. It's really cool to come and visit you.
Thanks for coming out, man.
Yeah, and obviously we're gonna have some amazing beers. We've got this great lineup here, but first let's talk a bit about, you know, how long you guys been around, how you started. So how long?
Sure, we've been here 10 months now, actually open to the public, so. Short run, but it's been crazy so far.
Was it kind of what you expected, or?
Absolutely, or everything I hoped it would be, I should say. Yeah, so.
And do you find kind of a strong local following?
Absolutely,
what's that like? Do a lot of locals come
Tons
in?
Tons of regulars. Every weekend we got the same faces in here, which is so cool. I can't appreciate those people more, you know, than I do, so.
But what happens when you don't have their favorite beer? Like you rotate a fair amount. So we were coming in here going, wow, can't wait to try this and there. So you have like six awesome beers on, but you actually on your webpage have a whole bunch of beers.
Sure, yeah, and a lot of those are seasonal, but we've cycled through a lot of different stuff because we like experimenting. We like playing around with a bunch of different varieties of beers and just playing, really just playing around.
Yeah, so, trying different stuff.
Yeah.
And the space itself is really cool. It's got a real communal feel. Like obviously it's got this immense table and this great, I mean, this bar we talked about during the tour is really, really awesome. in the spirit of craft beer, it looks like it's kind of about getting folks closer together than maybe they normally would be. They can't all huddle at their own little table.
Exactly, yeah. Again, another one of our goals was just making a space that people can come in, hang out, meet their neighbor, enjoy themselves, and just get to know all the people in Denver that like beer.
Well, yeah, the sort of, I mean, one of the things obviously within Denver that's happening is the almost a like neighborhood brewery movement. Is that, is that something you're
huge,
seeing?
Huge part of Denver, I think, right now is the neighborhood brewery. I think I'm really glad that that's sort of the way things are going, because I'm tired of the whole fighting for shelf space in retail stores and just packaging breweries. I don't really care about that. I want the experience that you get from going and like literally talking to the people that work there and just enjoying their company and trying their beer out.
And so how many folks work here? You have a small crew?
Four people, myself included. So a real skeleton crew, but great, just unbelievable people. I couldn't have asked for a better crew.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. So on the Denver scene, a lot of folks probably still starting up, but also folks have helped you. Are there any particular call outs for other breweries that helped you when you got started?
Definitely. Great Divide has always been huge for us. They've bent over backwards for us.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Which is really cool. Renegade has been super friendly, and Copper Kettle as well. All those guys have been really great about giving us advice, just helping us out when we need something, and we're trying to pay it forward as much as we can for the new guys too.
Yeah, so I think folks come talk to you and say, hey, we're going to start a brewery.
All the time, man. It seems like every day I'm talking to somebody new who wants to start another brewery.
It's kind of amazing. You know, like what a scene already. I think we talk about, you know, within the city and around the city, 60 breweries plus, and the options are incredible. Are there any particular beers you like that other folks make, like anything that you kind of go out of your way to try or have been blown away by?
Yeah. I'm really happy with what Hogshead is doing up in the Highlands.
Okay.
Those guys are just brewing some really, it's nothing that's going to blow your socks off, but it's just super fantastic British beer.
Yeah, so it's England, I think English style
exactly.
ales.
Exactly, yeah.
And do they go all the way to the casks and everything?
Yep. A lot of cask condition stuff.
Oh, that's awesome.
Dry hopped right in the cask and everything.
So as far as your growth, What sort of size brew house did you guys start out with?
So we started out with a 4-barrel system.
And you're still on that same system?
We're still in the same brew house. We just upgraded all our fermenters to be 7 barrels. So we basically more or less doubled our capacity.
And then was that just simply because you guys were selling all your beer?
We couldn't keep afloat at all. There were a lot of times where we'd have to shut down on random days just because we were so short on beer that it wasn't really worth it to be open. So
you saw people crying outside the
door? Yeah, a lot of times I'd be suffering in the brew house trying to make enough beer
and
see people walk up, try to get in here, and it's just, sorry, guys.
That's really interesting. Do you sell any off-site at all?
None.
So you're
all right here.
All the time, wow.
100%, yeah.
That's pretty awesome, actually.
I like it. I think that's really one of the directions I hope that things are going. Is less about the packaging, less about getting it out in the everywhere, mm-hmm. and more about creating a space that people can enjoy. So
right, but of course, when something like the competitions come up, you can take a pony keg or supply beer for metal competition, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, sure. So, we're looking to sponsor for like small shows, and our anniversary party is probably going to have a lot to do with setting up a lot of beer at a particular venue.
Yeah.
So,
anything, you ever supply beer to metal bands, perhaps?
We haven't yet. We've had visits from a couple, which has been really, really cool. I cannot be more thankful for the opportunities I've had to just meet some people who have been heroes to me for a long time, as far as music goes.
So how did you decide to say, hey, we're gonna kind of combine passion for music and passion for beer? Was it just supernatural for you to do that, or how did that kind of?
I saw it working perfectly in Chicago at Kuma's Corner. I will unabashedly say that those guys were 100% the inspiration for this place.
Okay.
They're a burger joint in Chicago. They do some of the best burgers you'll ever have in your life. And they do the same thing we do, is just inundate you with brutal metal.
During tap house hours, are you playing?
Yeah, we're playing whatever we want to play, what we listen to on the regular. So, we're not holding back, really. We'll taper it to what the crowd feels like.
Yeah.
And if it's slow, we might play something slower. If it's busy, we might play something upbeat.
Particular favorites or stuff that, I know it's always one of those, name one of 1,000 things you like.
Right.
But this week, what were your favorites this week?
So I just saw a local band play last night called In the Company of Serpents. They're a local doom band, two-piece, just really awesome.
Two-piece?
Yeah, two-piece.
Wow.
Just guitars and drums, and they kill it. They're just amazing stuff. Obviously, we named a band or one of our beers after Speed Wolf, one of the local bands around here that have been really good regulars of ours too.
Cool. So in other words, the local music guys.
Yeah, and that's a good sign. Like I say, one of the goals of our anniversary party is going to be to try to get, sort of showcase some of the local talent and give them an opportunity to, expose them to new people.
Oh, that's really cool. So one of the online guys asked, I think Jay Onasi asked, what about Camelot? Like it's, you know, what are your thoughts there?
It's a little too fantasy for me on it. Yeah, but you know, we typically sway a little more like doom, black metal, know, a little bit of, you know, crusty D beat or, you know, that sort of stuff once in a while. But yeah, we have our favorites, you know, maybe it sort of depends on who's working the bar. You know, that has a lot to do with
it. So the person working the bar, kind of, they pick
DJ, yeah, basically.
Oh, really? So they're like, hold on, I gotta...
Yeah, I'm like, oh, I'll pour you that beer in a second, I just gotta put more music on.
Oh, that's pretty cool. Yeah, because I noticed you have a turntable back there.
Right, yeah, we'll put records on, we'll put, you know, just play from an iPod, play from the radio, you know, whatever.
Has that kind of led to a certain set of folks coming here? In other words, has that broadened, or within the metal social media circles, you guys getting known for having awesome music as well as great beer?
I think that's helped. You know, the beer lover metalheads will come out, because they love beer, they love the music we're playing. The metalheads will just come out because they love the music we're playing. They don't know much about beer, so we're getting an opportunity to teach them about it. And then we get a lot of what my friends call normals coming in here too.
What would a normal be?
Just your average people, you know, just coming in, just craft beer people, just coming in because our beer, you know, is pretty solid, and you know, they like what we're doing here.
Do they ever come in and kind of go, whoa, that's definitely my ears? Like, it's about, they can put their beard into their ears though, is usually to sort of
take their utilikilt and pull it over their head or something.
But I mean, I imagine some people might not realize, you know what I mean? They may not, if they don't research you guys very much, they might not realize how serious you are about this.
They may not know what they're getting into, but we don't play it at such an intensity that they can't enjoy their time.
So the glasses aren't like shaking.
Nothing like that.
That kind of be counterproductive, I guess. For having a nice relaxed conversation. One other thing that's really cool, I mean, folks are probably getting them behind on the wall. There's a lot of like doodles, some of which are formally by your artists.
Exactly. Really great artist, Sam Turner, who does all of our merchandise. Just an amazingly talented guy.
And he just draws.
You know, he'll be sitting in here having a beer after his, you know, day job, and he'll just draw something on one of our menus. And, you know, we feel obligated, or we love to put it up on the wall.
But there's fan stuff, too.
Like a lot of other people come in here as well, and they'll, you know, do the exact same thing. They just, you know, see a blank canvas and start doing on it.
That's totally cool.
Yeah.
As far as your growth, I mean, do you not ever want to get into bottles or cans, you think?
I honestly don't know.
At this point, it's not really something that...
It's not a goal that we're looking at anytime soon. We might package on a small scale just for a limited release type stuff, just for the fun of it, really, you know?
Just to get it out there for some folks.
Yeah, and we'd only sell it here.
Do you do growler fills at all? Or?
We do on a limited basis, so we do what we call our cult, which is a sort of membership program.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so you buy a membership, you get a, you know, the people who buy in are the only ones who actually get the opportunity to fill growlers here.
Oh, cool. So it's like a club.
Exactly.
Or a cult.
Yes.
Perhaps.
Yeah, exactly.
And so do you have any restriction on what folks can get as part of that, or they can?
Luckily, nowadays we don't. So it's prefix A, which is really cool. Any growler fill is the exact same price. It's $7. That, you know, may change
next year.
That's
pretty awesome.
Yeah, it's really, especially now for Nazareth, where you're paying, you know, the same price for a growler fill you would pay for a pint of it. It works. That was our goal, was to make it, you know, pay off in the end for the people who are really devoted and wanted to, you know, sort of support us right from the get-go.
Right. So where does the name True come from?
It's really lame because it's online jargon.
Okay.
So it's a kind of a weird way to name your brewery, but I thought it really fitting because it tends to describe people who might be taking themselves a little too seriously within the metal community. And I kind of wanted to poke a little fun at those guys and just say, come in here, we'll play something you like, but don't get all serious about it. Just let's just hang out and have a good time and not take ourselves too seriously.
Do you ever have noobs come in and like have trouble pronouncing it? Like
they're like, TRVE is a pretty consistent one, which is hilarious. TRVE is also a good one, but I thought people would figure it out more than they did.
So what's your personal philosophy about beer styles? How do you think of them?
I would say that my philosophy is that I just don't really give a shit. My personal philosophy really is, if you're brewing a beer that people appreciate and enjoy and will drink the hell out of, you're doing the job right.
So. And so did you come at this as a home brewer, like originally?
Yeah, I was home brewing for probably about 4 or 5 years before I started this place up, and I dove real deep into it and just was brewing consistently once or twice a week for quite some time.
Were there any particular, like, are some of these beers kind of some of the ones you perfected while home brewing?
There are a couple of holdovers from the homebrew days. Wanderlust has been around from day one. Prehistoric Dog I had brewed at home the first time, our salted wheat beer. That's one of our sort of weirder ones that you talked about.
Yeah, I thought that one looked really interesting. I mean, you don't have it on, but that looked like a really cool...
Brewing it tomorrow. You're just missing it. We're doing a big pig roast for it, too.
So really?
It's going to be real fun, yeah. So next couple of weeks, we're going to have a big party to release that one.
And had you ever brewed professionally prior to...
Never.
So you just... I'm a gearhead. Yeah. I'm a tinkerer. I love figuring stuff out. And that's where I'm coming at it from, is the love of building things, the love of figuring out problems. And I just sort of dove into it and said, you know, I can figure this out.
So you figured out brewing in a sense, and then you go, okay, now let's figure out a brewery, because you have to scale up, right?
Exactly, yeah. Because we're at such a small scale, it was less of an issue to scale up to the point we're at now.
Yeah, so you know, it's more like the 30 barrels.
Exactly, yeah. So it's the efficiencies are pretty close, you know, ingredients we haven't had to tweak too much, so... Really, a lot of these recipes scaled pretty well. Not to say that I'm resting on, you know, my ass and just sitting around. We're constantly trying to fix them up and make them even better than before.
Are you trying a lot of still developing new beers as well?
Like, absolutely. Yeah, we don't. It's funny. We don't really pilot a lot of things these days. Since we brew at such a small scale, we've been able to try it the first time and get it probably like 95% there, and then make the other 5% tweak. You know, the next batch or two.
So it's a really quick process for you to kind of do a new beer.
Exactly.
And then it's up here on the tap room, and the locals will go, hey, what? Yes or no, you know?
Like, exactly. And typically they're going yes, so I'm not complaining.
Now let's talk about the beers. I mean, starting really at a high level first, like the naming. I mean, you guys, it's a pretty cool names. I'm guessing metal inspired.
Just a little bit, yeah.
Like 100%? Like,
yep, exactly.
So when you come up with the beer, do you know, like, do you have that idea of what you want to name it around, whether it's a song or a band? Like, how does that kind of come into play?
It kind of works both ways. I have definitely come up with a name, or saw a song title, for instance, and said, okay, we need to name a beer after that, and then figure out the style that sort of aligns with that. Or we have brewed a beer and then been like, oh shit, we need a name. And then, you know, I'll sort of rack
You'll
my brain
it,
and try to
figure it
out and say like, okay, this, you know, this tastes like what that sounds like, you know? So we've come at it from both angles for sure.
That's interesting. That's really cool. Let's start taking a little look at these. And obviously one thing for folks to remember is with beer, you want to be considered a pour order. That's what I always call it. Like the order which you'll taste your beers, because if you go with something too hoppy, too bitter, too roasty off the bat, it'll kind of mess up. Your sort of flavor. I'm wondering if the Hellion, the one we've been drinking, this one, would that be the first of these you'd start with?
That's usually one of the two I point people to start off with. It's that or Wanderlust are typically our sort of less harsh, very easy entryway sort of beers that people can start their session off with. And then move
on started.
To the, yeah, exactly. That's what the palate.
The Hellion American table beer. Like, so it's a, do you do any lagers or are they all ales?
We just did our first lager, actually.
Oh, really?
It's not on tap yet. It's fermenting as we speak.
Right.
But
so this one is an ale.
This one is, everything we have now is ales.
Okay.
So, yeah.
And what is a table beer? What is?
You know, it's my way of saying just an easy, sessionable beer that you could, you know, match with food if you wanted to.
Right.
You can drink a bunch of them if you need to or if you want to. The session beer term is a little too blanket for me.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to come up with something a little more appropriate for what I thought that would be good for.
Yeah, and it's a 4.2%, and it's, you know, it's got a little more character. It's not as, it doesn't have that super cleanness that a lager has, but still it's a pretty clean, fairly dry beer, I found. Mild bitterness. It's almost like if you made an ale to kind of be like a lager.
Exactly. It's funny you say that, because when you think of most metalheads, what they typically are drinking is PBR, Banquet, you know, the big, boring, you know, mass-produced lagers.
Yeah.
They go for this like crazy. That's the beer that they will always go to. A bunch of my friends who don't necessarily drink a lot of craft beer will come in here and will drink the hell out of Hellion.
So next, probably the Wanderlust, you think? And I think we've got them in order. So this was the Hellion's.
This is Hellion right here, yep. So I would say Wanderlust is next. Kind of our flagship, in a sense, which is... surprising to me in a way. It's one of the ones that I've sort of been working on the most, and I'm still always kind of tweaking it a little bit, but just a Belgian American pale ale, you know, a Belgian yeast with sort of the Belgian base malts, but a lot of American hops. We use actually an experimental hop variety called HBC 342.
That's very catchy.
Yeah, right? It's a lot of new hop varieties, you know, when they're piloting them, they will...
They'll kind of like number them. And
exactly.
It's really, you know, it's funny because immediately you get that like kind of Belgian yeast, kind of bit of ester.
Exactly.
A little light fruitiness. And
I find it finishes with a little bread.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
I get a little bit of almost like a melon type thing going on there sometimes.
Yeah. Definitely some kind of fruit.
Yeah.
You know, like it's
citrusy, melony.
Yeah, and it's really, actually, this one, again, actually drier than the Hellion, I find. Like, and so it's, this really gives me that.
It really dries out.
Yeah, this really gives me the, okay.
Yeah.
You gotta, your tongue is saying, give me more.
Yep.
It's like the permanence, I need more of this beer. This is really tasty. I think.
Thank you.
It's been interesting. I've seen at the various places, almost everyone does like a Belgian pale ale. It seems to be a very common style that people love to play with.
I think Belgian breweries have such a history that you kind of have to pay homage to that at some point, you know. Well, some breweries are entirely devoted to that. Some breweries don't do it at all.
Right.
I think that most, not to say middle of the road, but you know, any brewery that's worth their salt should probably take a stab at a Belgian beer at some point.
Had you been doing like homebrewing Belgian styles when you were?
Again, that's one of the ones that I'd been working on at home for
quite some time. Well, that's right. So this has been something you've been refining for a while.
Exactly.
And so then this is another one of your, I think, probably gateway beers. If someone, like, you know, this, the Hellion, super drinkable, kind of like lower alcohol, very approachable. This, hey, you want a little more character, a little more fruit.
Little more alcohol, a little more stuff going on there.
Well, I would say it's more bitter, but definitely, I mean, it may hint, but like you said, like definitely you get that Belgian character.
For sure, for sure. Estery, interesting, just good stuff going on. Just nice, really, drinkable beer.
Really tasty.
After those two gateway ones, we usually move people on to, in the tasting array here, the Death Ripper.
Yeah, I had a bit of that earlier. And that was really, you know, again,
it's a different beer.
Denver 666 Common.
Exactly.
Is this sort of like your version of like the San Francisco steam beer? Like,
not even at all.
I wouldn't say in the sense of the recipe, but just like sort of the inspiration of.
Sure.
Were there old miners that used to drink this kind of beer, you think? And
it's funny you say that. It's
they dug deep in the ground and found strange
it's
artifacts.
It's roughly based off of a Kentucky Common. I don't talk about that too much,
really?
Because I don't want people to get a preconceived notion of what it should taste like.
Right.
I wanted to create my own beer, but I was looking at some historical styles that haven't been brewed in a long time.
Wow.
And that was one that came up
on
the radar.
It's got nice hops on the nose.
Like, I mean, hop the hell out of it.
Yeah, so like, you know, again, often darker beer, this kind of look, you'll think like brown ale, and then typically not that hoppy. Hoppy in Colorado, I'm finding, like, as people like the hops here. But this, yeah, had a really nice hop.
Yeah, for sure. We dry hop the hell out of it. We use a blend called Falconer's Flight, which was developed as a sort of a stopgap for, you know, the shortcomings in supply of some of the more popular aroma varieties like Simcoe and Citra and Amarillo. You just can't find those, but you can get a blend that does exactly what you need it to do, and we are more than happy with the results we get out of it. So.
Yeah, I mean, this one has a wonderful, I mean, like I said, nice hoppiness on the front. Also, the taste, there's a bit of hoppiness, but then super light body.
Sure.
I mean, but little tiny roasty notes, but nothing crazy, not a lot of caramel or nothing sweet, and then it just kind of like goes, again, dries out really nice.
Exactly. We someone described it as flinty, which I think is
flinty,
one of the most accurate notes accurate representations I've heard so far.
Well, kind of minerally, maybe, yeah. Like that, it's got like that finish is, like in wine, they discuss like the minerally qualities.
Sure.
And then they put their finger.
We're getting too snobby now.
Like, I'll do my drink with my beer like this. Minerally qualities. Lower ABV too, as well, like 4.2.
We wanted a drinkable, dry hopped, light bodied, but dark beer. We wanted to basically confuse all your senses as much as we could with that one.
So next, would you do the stout or would you do the Nazareth?
Like, I think I would bounce to stout now.
Okay. Other letters on the stout's name. Is stout? Oh, like,
so
what tell us about that one?
The name of stout is based off a band called Sun.
Okay.
It's spelled the exact same way as our stout. Two dudes on guitar is basically playing the droniest, longest, deepest music you've ever heard, and it's just like holding on to a note forever and ever.
Do you think they may be laying down when they play? Is it possible?
It's like... I know there's a lot of fog machines involved, so that could be part of it.
Lights
and druid robes as well.
Oh yeah.
So
nice. So yeah. Let's do that then.
Absolutely.
So where'd this beer come from?
Just an American style stout.
Ooh, big, nice coffee.
Big, yeah, roasty chocolate, coffee nose.
Yeah, really big, really big.
But super drinkable again. Not something that's going to inundate you.
Oh,
not something that's going to blow your face off and make it so you can't session on it. You could drink four of those, and you might be a little fucked up, but you'll be able to make it through them all.
And so then I think we get to numero six.
Nazareth.
Named after?
Sleep.
Sleep. What about the classic Canadian band, Nazareth?
Nope. Sorry.
Common misconception.
I know. Sorry to bum
you out. Those guys weren't metal. I mean, they were something. They were kind of.
Yeah, it was like hair metal.
Hair rock.
Even.
No, they were pre-hair.
Pre-hair.
Pre-hair. You know, like
bald metal.
No. They weren't like
the rats and the poisons.
Poison. Who was the other one? Motley Crue. Well, yeah, Motley Crue is a little bit, but
yeah, they're...
Twisted Sister. Like, I remember. Do you have any Twisted Sister beers?
You're killing me right now.
D. Snyder beers. D. Snyder's gonna come here and say, "I want you to brew me a beer." So Nazareth is.
So Nazareth, a band called Sleep, and they wrote a song called Dope Smoker.
Yeah, because I know there's some kind of ode to the spliff comment on
that. Yeah, so the song is 1 hour and 3 minutes long.
Hour and 3 minutes.
Yeah, and it is the ultimate ode to partaking in a particular substance.
Right, which is legal in Colorado.
Yeah, which we just legalized, so I guess I could talk about it.
Right? it'll be totally discreet.
It's a beer that's dedicated to a song that's dedicated to smoking weed. That's what it is. And we went for the dankest of dank beers that we could possibly brew.
Well, yeah, so. I mean, really big. You know, grassy, resinous, I would say. Like, not citrus.
Exactly. Tons of Columbus, which gives you that sort of dank flavor profile. A little bit of Summit to get you, kind of gives you a little bit of that oniony garlic, but I like that comes in because that gives it a sort of, a little bite.
Of the other ones you make, is there any particular fan favorite? I mean, you have a lot of really cool ones. There was what was the saison you guys did?
We did a Diatima, which is a smoked tea saison.
Now that seems like a really interesting one.
It's awesome. I love it. It's not one of those, it's one of those ones that's hit or miss for particular people.
Yeah, yeah.
Some people love it. They just can't get enough of it. Other people just can't handle that smoky sort of flavor that comes with it.
Right.
So I think that's sort of characteristic of a lot of smoked beers.
Right. Yeah, some smoked beers, I mean, the Rausch beers and those can be, the people are like love them or hate them. It's like scotches or whatever, right?
Yeah,
like,
and the interesting thing is this is a smoke unlike any other smoke you'll get. It's not peat, it's not Rausch. I honestly have never been able to come up with the words to describe the smoke character that is in that without saying, have you ever had the tea we use in it before?
Oh, it was Lapsang Souchong.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's a crazy tea.
Yeah.
I have a funny story about Lapsang Souchong. So I quit coffee because I got addicted to it and I was drinking 20 cups a day. So I said, I'm going to go to Lapsang Souchong. It's totally benign. But if you ever had it, it's like super smoky, like kind of caustic if you drink
it's
it.
It's intense.
So I would drink like 10 cups of that a day. And then the funniest thing I did is we were working on one of our games and I left a cup of it in this office. And it was our sound guy's office. And I totally forgot, and I walk off and rent. And then I come back again, I see everything's powered down, all the cables are unplugged. I go, something's burning, there's some ozone smell in here. And I'm like, oh,
no, it's just my tea.
And actually that's the thing, is like Lapsang Souchong is so distinct. It's remarkable how powerfully identifiable it is.
If you have the tea, I usually associate it with campfire. That's usually the flavor I get out of it when you steep it as an actual tea. The thing about how we use it is we treat it as a dry hop. So we actually put it in the beer post-fermentation.
So you put it in like a little tea bag and...
Exactly. We just steep it like any other dry hop.
Interesting.
Yeah, and it since it's cold steeped in that beer, it doesn't bring out that acrid sort of like burnt note. It brings out something totally different. Yeah. Which is totally unique to that beer, I think. So
very, very cool. All these are really delicious beers. I mean, it's really great to see folks making some unique styles, and then secondarily, with existing styles, putting some kind of interesting twists and turns on them. But you know, for the sake of, you know, drinkability and enjoyability, you know, like I think these are all really, really tasty.
We don't try to put things in beer to make it quirky. We put it in there to make it interesting and drinkable.
Yeah, for sure. So. And the other thing, really key. Is there's so many breweries, if you don't make great beer, you're screwed.
I think that's coming around. I think that if you're not pulling your weight here in Colorado, you're not going to last long. My only hope and my only goal is to be making beer that's on par with some of the greats that are here in state. And some of those guys come in here and they tell me regularly that I'm doing a good job.
That's
so
awesome.
I think that's the best feedback I can ask for, is that, you know, dudes on the level of Avery and Great Divide and Odell are coming in here and telling me, like, you guys are killing it. You're making great beer.
That's good.
So
speaking of great beer, one of the last things I do on a show is pick my favorite. I got to tell you, I think I would probably say Death Ripper.
Really? Cool.
I think the Death Ripper for me, again, I'm a brown ale fan, so it's interesting to have a bit of the roastiness, but then with the hops mixed in, and it's still really balanced and drink. I like sessional beers as well. So that's why, I mean, like, I think Hellion was really cool because it's just like, yeah, you could drink this all day.
I personally think that, I'll go off on a tangent here, but I think that I'm personally exhausted by this like gigantic beer thing that's going on in craft beer.
I think there's a real trend to what you're talking about.
Yeah, I think that session beers are really going to be a thing that when you see Avery brewing, you know, 3.5, they're, you know, super sessionable IPA.
Yeah.
And you see other big breweries brewing, you know, like session beers that are 4% or, you know, within range. I think that's a sign of the, you know, the tide's shifting a little bit away from the 10, 12, whatever it is percentage.
Those aren't necessarily good for you to session.
I want you to hang out and have, you know, you can only have so much conversation in one beer.
Yeah.
You can have way more conversation in like three or four beers.
Yeah,
if you're not going to get totally messed up on those three or four beers, we're going to have a great conversation.
I think so. I mean, like I said, the Death Ripper, I think that the hops element and then my expectation being kind of completely flipped on its head after you try it was what it did for me. So
I'll pass that along to the band because they're local and I think they'll appreciate that. So
cool. This has been an awesome visit. We have had all kinds of great beer. I mean, like, the beers you make are delicious. I've had a wonderful selection. I mean, it's one of those things that, you know, I'd love to come by again at some point, try some of the other seasonals and that, and then maybe I'll get that chance. Really, I just want to thank you and say cheers.
Absolutely. Skol.
Na zdrovje.